Welcome back, everyone. Like the NFL, the NBA seems destined for a lockout and a prolonged labor battle. Last week in New York, players and owners met in hopes of avoiding a work stoppage. One of the guys at the table for the players, Hornets superstar Chris Paul. The NBA lost $300 million last season. Because of this, owners want to restructure the league's business model. They plan to do that partially by eliminating contracts being fully guaranteed and instituting a hard salary cap. The players, though, they don't seem thrilled with that idea.
Like I said, both sides made moves, you know what I mean? But we're still very, very far apart on what we're trying to get done. So, you know, we're not in favor of that hard cap and stuff like that. But we're going to keep talking, keep meeting, and do whatever we have to do to try to get this deal done.
Joined once again by Gabe Feldman, director of the sports law program at Tulane Law School. We talked in the last segment about the NFL, kind of a rosy picture for them. It looks like the lockout may be ending and football may be played as normal, no interruptions. The NBA, though, I think it's going to be not so pretty. What is your take on the future of next the NBA season and this lockout as it moves forward?
Yeah, I think whatever the opposite of rosy is the situation we face in the NBA. I think the sides are so far apart. It's not a gap, it's a gulf. And it looks like we're headed to a lengthy work stoppage or lengthy litigation. The NBA owners, unlike the NFL owners, are claiming that the NBA system is broken and needs to be fundamentally overhauled. It's going to take a big fight to get there. And to put it in perspective, a lot of NBA owners feel they will lose less money if they don't play the games and if they do play the games.
And you were explaining to me about the pyramid system, I guess if you want to look at it that way, where in the NFL, just for the people watching, you have owners versus players. It's very simple. Owners, players, how do we cut it all up? But in basketball, I thought you did a great job of explaining the fight and how it may be a pyramid effect.
Yeah, it's not only players versus owners, it's also big market owners versus small market owners. And when the NBA says to the players, a lot of our teams are losing money, we need money back from you, the players. The players say, well, it looks like the Lakers are doing pretty well. It looks like the big market teams are doing pretty well. Why not give some of that money to the small market owners? That will solve the small market problem. And the owner's response to that is, well, that's our problem. We'll handle that internally. We need money back from you first, then we'll deal with our revenue sharing. So it is a bit of a triangle effect we have going on here.
You worked for the New Jersey Nets. Obviously, you study situations like these labor negotiations. Who is eventually going to come out the winner and the loser in the NBA situation? And again, we talked about hockey. Hockey took a whole season off to get their business model right. Ted Leonis, the owner of the Washington Capitals, also owns the Washington Wizards. He says that the business model in the NBA is worse than the business model in the NHL when they took a whole year off. When this dust settles, who wins in this?
I think the NHL is the perfect model to look at because the NBA owners do compare themselves to the NHL back in 2004, and it looks difficult to see a deal getting done without the players losing a fair amount. I think the losers, again, to the extent that we can say they're losers in this battle, will be the players because they're going to give some money back, and the big market owners because they're going to give some money back too. The deal will not get done unless both the players and the big markets give some money to the small market teams. Otherwise, we can't have an NBA with small market teams.
You're right. You have to contract 15 teams to have the system like it is now. This directly affects the Hornets because they're one of those small market teams. Does a lockout benefit the Hornets, hurt the Hornets? In what has to happen for the Hornets to survive and be successful here?
Yeah, I think a lockout hurts the entire NBA. I think a system change helps the NBA. I don't know that you need a lockout to get that system change. We might go through a lengthy lockout, but there's another way to do it, and the players feel they have another option, and that's to break up their union, bring an antitrust suit, and fight in the courts. That way you don't get a work stoppage. The NBA players might be able to block the lockout, sue under antitrust law while they're negotiating a new deal. Either way, whether it's through lockout and a work stoppage or an antitrust suit, the system has to change, not just for New Orleans. The problems New Orleans is having right now with the Hornets is not an indictment on the city. It's an indictment on the NBA system. Small market teams throughout the NBA are struggling. They're struggling perhaps because the players are making too much money, but also because they cannot compete with the big markets in terms of their television deals and their stadium concession deals. You think about how much money the Lakers make on their local TV deal, and per game on ticket sales, the Hornets, the Kings, the Pacers, they just can't compete. So we need some system fix.
I look at the world through rose-colored glasses. I think the NBA is going to get this fixed, whether they take an entire year off or they take 1 week off. I really do believe that they're going to get the system fixed. I don't know how you feel about that, but I think they will, and I do think small markets will be better taken care of. Do you think a local owner will emerge then, potentially Gary Schwest or a conglomerate of local business leaders in save the Hornets, buy the Hornets, keep them here locally?
I do. I think we might even have an owner now if it weren't for the threat of this lockout, even with the old system. But once we get a new system, and there will be a new system, we just don't know the details of the new system. And again, we know players will be giving money, big markets will be giving money, small markets will be getting more money from two sides. That'll make this a much more attractive option. It'll make all small markets a much more attractive option. So I do think an NBA team is certainly viable in New Orleans. It's just as viable in New Orleans as it is in Indianapolis, as it is in Sacramento, and all other small markets out there. The shift in this NBA financial structure will certainly help the team, which will in turn will help attract a new owner.
All right, before we go, just like we did for our last segment with the NFL, does the NBA, we're going to have a little rapid fire here, does the NBA miss games? In 1999, they missed 30 games the last time they had a labor situation. So assuming a lockout happens, which I think is a safe assumption, does it get into the season? Does the NBA miss any games at all?
If there's a lockout and the players are unable to block that lockout with their antitrust suit, I do think we miss regular season games, maybe a significant number of them.
Does the business model get fixed the right way, or do the big market owners win and the small market owners continue to lose in all of this, or do they fix it the right way?
I think they fix it to some extent the right way. I don't know how much money the big markets will end up giving to the small markets, but there will be more revenue sharing between big markets and small markets.
Do the Hornets stay in New Orleans long term?
Yes.
All right. Gabe Feldman, Tulane University, director of the sports law program there. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks again for having me on.
All right.